President.
The Majority Whip.
Mr. President, I heard the remarks of our colleague from Illinois, and I too hope that we can get past the rhetoric and the talking points of the past and actually do something meaningful when it comes to public safety and address these terrible tragedies like the one that occurred at Stoneman Douglas High School in Florida just 2 weeks ago. But we're not going to do it by trotting out all of our laundry lists of requests and say it has to be all of this or nothing. Because when you say here in Washington, and particularly in Congress, I want everything on my list or I want nothing, one thing is for sure, you'll end up with nothing. And that simply is an unacceptable outcome, particularly when it comes to the public safety crisis manifested here most recently at Stoneman Douglas High School in Florida. We know that there were many, many failures. You might even call this a systemic failure when it comes to the children at Stoneman Douglas High School. First and foremost, why didn't federal and local law enforcement follow up on threats and warnings? This young man, the shooter, who took the lives of 17 people, he telegraphed in very clear, unmistakable language what he intended to do. But the very people that we trust and entrust with public safety at the federal and state level did not respond. We know the alleged shooter was expelled from school for disciplinary reasons. We know that deputies in Broward County received at least 18 calls warning them over the course of several years. 18 calls. We know about the disturbing YouTube post where the shooter basically said what he intended to do and did in fact do later. And we know that the FBI received many disturbing tips from citizens about the imminent danger posed by the shooter. Another question is whether mental health officials could have done more. We know that this young man had a long history of violent outbursts. In 2016, we're told that he reportedly attempted suicide by drinking gasoline. He'd been accused of verbal slurs against racial and religious minorities. Now, we know Florida has a state law, like some have advocated at the federal level, but a state law that permits forced hospitalization of people with psychiatric and mental health crises. But it seems that in this particular case, mental health workers concluded that this individual was stable at the time they examined him. Why and how was that determination made? And why does that stand in such stark contrast to the picture that we've been able to draw as a result of all of the information that we've received since this terrible shooting? If law enforcement, public health workers, school officials were communicating and coordinating effectively, would they have made the same decisions in this case? Could they have made a difference in the outcome? Well, I think we need the answers to those questions. But there are two other questions that we need to answer as well. One is why and how did the shooter have access to firearms in the first place? And why didn't the school's armed resource officer intervene once the shooting began? All of us are angry at the fact that this shooting happened. But that shouldn't tempt us into easy solutions that in the end of the day would not make any difference in the outcome. They wouldn't do any good. That's what we tend to get here in Congress when we have hard issues like this, easy solutions, talking points that lead to no effective action. And we can't let that happen here. As one columnist put it last week, we can't fall victim to the politics of false hope. The most frequent refrain I hear in Washington after some tragedy like this occurs is that we need to do something. Well, we need to do something effective, something that would change the likely outcome. We may not be able to protect every citizen against terrible tragedies like this, but there are things that we can do which make things better and that will be effective in changing the outcome, and I believe in saving lives. Real solutions require us to look at why the FBI and local law enforcement failed to respond to multiple warnings. I asked one police officer about this. He said, well, in America, we can't arrest somebody for pre-crime. In other words, we can't arrest somebody for an offense that they didn't commit yet. It is perhaps a flaw that's unfortunately exposed in our system when we can't anticipate who might commit these terrible offenses and stop them before they commit the act. And that is a feature of our law enforcement system. But this isn't just another job for law enforcement. There's a lot more people who can contribute to a solution here and prevent these incidents from happening beyond simply law enforcement, who are, by our very Constitution, structured to investigate and prosecute crimes that have already occurred, not to stop them in the first place. I think it's a fair question to ask is, what is the role of social media in preventing mass violence? When you have people basically telling us what they're getting ready to do and posting those on social media, and nothing seems to happen as a consequence, it strikes me that something is terribly wrong there. What is the responsibility of these platforms? Well, we know that Congress has said, for example, you have a responsibility to police your platform from things like child pornography. In other words, they can't be totally oblivious to the things that are being posted on these social media platforms. They have a responsibility to intervene in some cases, and maybe it ought to be in more cases. What options currently exist to reporting disturbing content online? I believe in the YouTube video case, it was somebody who actually saw it and was disturbed by it and then reported it to the FBI. It was not even YouTube itself that identified it. Of course, they would be in the best position to identify it immediately. It was some third party who happened to see it and was disturbed by it and contacted the FBI. And tragically, it was never followed up on. But how often are these popular platforms forwarding reports to the police or federal authorities when people actually threaten to commit acts of violence? If there are holes in the reporting protocol, we should close them. That's why I think this is a systemic failure. When you look at mental health providers, when you look at law enforcement officials, when you look at the schools, when you look at the social media platforms, when you look at all of this together, I think it begins to give us some ideas about things we can do that may end up saving lives. And we should do them. Members are discussing, of course, many ideas, which always happens after a tragedy like this. And I'm open to a conversation with anyone who shares my desire to take effective action to prevent another one of these tragedies. But there is one proposal that's already been introduced that's won bipartisan support and has brought together advocates from all sides. It is really a unique piece of legislation because there's not many times that I can think of where people who are strong Second Amendment advocates and people who believe there ought to be more controls imposed on guns can come together and find consensus to find common ground. But we have on a bill that I introduced to strengthen the background check system called the Fix NICS Act. It may take a long time to answer all the questions raised by the tragedy in Parkland, but one step we can take right now is to pass the Fix NICS bill. This has the unique quality of causing our colleague from junior senator from Connecticut, and me to co-introduce this bill, we couldn't be more ideologically different. He's a Democrat, I'm a Republican. But we have come together on a bill that does enjoy broad bipartisan support that I believe will save lives. This, of course, was introduced in the wake of the shooting last fall at a small community near San Antonio called Sutherland Springs, Texas. As we will recall, a deranged gunman with a criminal record and a history of violence and mental illness opened fire during a Sunday morning church service, killing 26 people and wounding 20 more. Tragically, to add to the tragedy that already occurred, this murderer's criminal conviction records were never uploaded in the FBI's National Instant Criminal Background Check system. So when he went to purchase firearms, he lied about his record, and there was nothing in the criminal background check system to show that he lied and denied him, and thus deny him the opportunity to purchase the weapons. This failure to enforce our background check law allowed this shooter to walk into a gun store, pass a background check, and illegally purchase a firearm. This bipartisan legislation would tighten the National Instant Criminal Background Check system. It's supported by people all across the political spectrum. And it's even co-sponsored by the Democratic leader, Senator Schumer, and supported by Every Town for Gun Safety. It's brought together all sides in the gun debate, leaders on the Republican side and Democratic side alike. Under current law, mentally ill individuals and persons convicted of violent crimes are prohibited by law, by current law, of purchasing or possessing firearms. This would make sure that these laws are enforced and that criminal history information is uploaded into the NICS database by state and federal authorities. For years, our colleagues across the aisle have said that they want reforms that will help stem the tide of gun violence perpetrated by dangerous criminals. Well, this is their chance. This is our chance. It's our chance to show the nation that we refuse to accept shootings at schools and churches as the new normal. And we can do that, we can start doing that by passing Fix NICS this week. Senator Schumer, the minority leader, said yesterday he wants to wait, even though he's a co-sponsor of the Fix NICS bill. He's a co-sponsor of the bill, but he says he wants to wait. He wants to wait and debate other ideas he knows are controversial and can't pass. Of course, that is his right as a United States senator. But as I said earlier, if our attitude is, I want everything on my list or nothing, we're going to end up with nothing. And I, for one, am not willing to go home and look my constituents in the face and said, we had an opportunity to pass legislation, the Fix NICS bill, that will save lives in the future, will make sure that existing laws are enforced. I won't go home and tell them that in good faith we've done everything we can in our power to help save lives by passing bipartisan legislation that could pass today if it was put on the floor and voted on by a supermajority of the United States Senate. So I would implore our Democratic colleagues to change course. Let's do the art of the possible. That's what politics is, the art of the possible. Let's do what we can immediately to pass Fix NICS and build from there. I'm willing to work with them. The president's willing to work with them on things like bump stocks, the mental health failure. Try to make sure our schools are safer. Make sure that social media platforms report threats of violence to law enforcement officials so they can be followed up on. There's a lot of other things we can do. But the one thing we can do this week before we go home is to pass the Fix NICS bill and to send it to the House and then to the President and sign it into law. It will save lives. Mr. President, I yield the floor.